the right kind of sandstone somewhere else. His search takes him a world away to Southern California.
Looks like a promising prospect.
Yeah.
While the ocean view is a sharp contrast to the Jordanian desert, the sandstone is identical to Petra's. Paradise enlists stonemasons Blake Rankin and Nathan Hunt. With permission from the landowner, they search for just the right rock. Hunt is a classically trained master carver and architectural sculptor with over 18 years of experience.
We're looking for a fine-grained sandstone which lends itself to ornamental carving.
Sandstone is a soft rock made of compressed layers of sand and minerals.
That looks like the type of stone we're looking for. Yeah, this is great. It looks like it's going to carve really well.
The team has found the perfect rock and cliff face. Now, they must find the right tools for the job. Back in Petra, Paradise discovers a clue in the stone. Chisel marks made from iron tools.
The technologies used with chisels and stonework haven't changed in 2,000 years. We use the same chisels, and so they leave the same marks.
By matching modern-day tool marks with those found in Petra, their advisor, Tom Paradise, tells them exactly which tools to use. The claw chisel, the flat chisel, and the pointed chisel.
The pointed chisel is used for the coarser chiseling that removes large amounts of rock.
So the pointed chisel is exactly what Hunt and Rankin use to begin work.
Yeah, feels good to be carving.
But their exuberance fades fast. Carving by hand is seriously slow.
There's no way we can do it by hand.
A Greek source says the Nabataeans had few slaves, but they probably did have plenty of skilled manpower and time. Hunt and Rankin have neither, but they have power tools. Even so, Rankin insists they're not cheating.
This is a chisel very similar to one that the Nabataeans would have used. The only difference is that we've mechanized the hammer process so that we can move a lot of stone really quickly.
The carvers have found the right rock and the right tools for the job. As Hunt and Rankin prepare the cliff face, Paradise must decide what exactly to carve. What makes a Nabataean tomb Nabataean? Many of the facades in Petra actually look like they belong somewhere else. At the treasury, Paradise finds statues, columns, and capitals reminiscent of ancient Greece and Rome. And across Petra, he finds architectural features from other far-flung empires. A step design associated with Assyria and Mesopotamia. Elephant-headed capitals evoking India. Even Egyptian obelisks. But among the familiar are designs Paradise has seen nowhere else.
There's a pediment on the top that is split in the middle, capped by a cone, a capital, and an urn at the top. This isn't Greek, this isn't Roman.
This new design is seamlessly mixed with features from far-off cultures.
The architecture is the synthesis, and this begins to tell us a story that is the real Petra.
What makes a Nabataean tomb Nabataean is the combining of their own unique style with designs from other empires. But how did these people in the middle of the desert come into contact with such faraway places? Two words, frankincense and myrrh. Frankincense and myrrh were must-have luxury items in antiquity. In the New Testament, they are among the gifts the three kings bring to the baby Jesus. Made from dried sap from trees in the southern Arabian Peninsula, They were burned obsessively in religious ceremonies in Egypt, Greece, and Rome. But to get that incense to consumers throughout the Mediterranean, it first had to be transported through the desert. After centuries of living as nomads, the Nabataeans knew every secret source of water. If you wanted to cross the desert and make it out alive, you had better have a Nabataean leading the way. Along the route, they built outposts to guard their goods and extract a toll. In a valley just over the mountain from Petra, Andrew Smith has excavated this fort called Bir Makur.
There was definitely a Nabataean presence here, most likely related to the trade that came out of Petra.
Among the artifacts he excavated are dozens of tiny clay perfume bottles.
The Nabataeans were most likely processing some of the raw frankincense. And they would have bottled and then packed them tightly so that they weren't going to break, and probably loaded them on camels or even donkeys.
The incense road became the lifeblood of the Nabataeans, pulsing from Saudi Arabia to the port of Gaza, the gateway to Greece and Rome. The financial reward from this trade catapults a desert tribe into a powerful kingdom. Nabataean towns and tombs spring up throughout the northwestern Arabian Peninsula. By the first century, the Roman writer Pliny called the Nabataeans the richest race on earth. Much of their wealth went into building their capital city, Petra. Tom Paradise believes the Nabataeans' far-flung trade connections influenced their domestic designs.
Because Petra is a crossroads for the region, it makes sense that they would adopt and adapt different architectural styles from a lot of their trading partners.
But with all these different styles, what should Paradise pick for his carving experiment?
This sort of facade represents more than 500 other facades in Petra. So this style really is the archetype of the tomb facades.
To Paradise, this tomb is typically Nabataean. Although it appears plain, it's a mashup of different architectural styles. It has the remains of a Greco-Roman doorway, Nabataean capitals, an Egyptian cornice, and a design from Assyria that may represent a stairway to heaven, called a crow step. But when the carving team transfers the design to California, it isn't wide enough to fit the rock.
You never really know how it's going to work in the stone until you get started.
We think it's going to look a lot better if we widen the facade.
But how will making the facade wider affect the design?
Make each block of the crow step 7 by 7 inch.
This would be the edge of the crow step.
That'd be great.
Grappling with this problem, the team may shed light on a mystery that has confounded scholars for decades. Why do Nabataean tombs, while similar, have unique variations?
There's one motif they modify a lot, and that is the crow step. Why the difference, we've never really understood.
Some of the tombs in Petra have crow steps that reach all the way down to a narrow ledge called the cornice. Other crow steps meet in the middle. Some scholars have argued this reflects an evolution in design. But Paradise thinks they have struck upon a practical reason.
As we make the facade wider, it really requires us to take the crow steps all the way down to the cornice.
If the facade is wider, the crow steps must break apart.
Increasingly, we notice that changes of the rock actually cause changes within the design elements. I think we have to give more credit to the rock than we have in the past.
Sort of roughly mark 9 inches on there, just start cutting it.
By carving their own facade, they discover a basic principle of Petra. The rock influences what they carve and where they carve it. But why here? Choosing to build their capital in the middle of a rocky desert poses another age-old question. How did the Nabataeans get enough water to support such a magnificent city? One clue is here in the city center, at a structure known as the Great Temple. Its monumental stairway leads to a large stone platform surrounded by over 100 columns. Holes in the courtyard show there are channels running underneath it.
It's running under the paved floor. Oh, that'll do it.
Sue Alcock leads a team from Brown University to investigate.
If we could make all this surface architecture go away, you know, just kind of magically lift it up and look down, I think we'd see quite a network of these channels and canals.
She may be short on magic, but Alcock does have another way to look below the surface, a technology called GPR, ground penetrating radar.
Excavation is inherently destructive. This is a way to get a look at what's down there in the same way you would go in for an X-ray, perhaps, before you went in for a surgery.
The radar sends a high-frequency radio wave into the ground. When the wave passes through different materials, like from stone to soil, part of the wave is reflected back. But the speed of the wave changes depending on the material. Slower for soil, faster through air. Detecting these changes is how the GPR sees where the channels are. The team systematically drags the radar back and forth across the courtyard.
There's some kind of a channel right there.
Oh yeah, look at that.
Beneath the Great Temple is a network of channels that looks like plumbing. Intriguingly, the channels seem to extend beyond the courtyard.
When we look at Petra, we often tend to think about building by building. And I think it was all tied together.
Alcock believes these channels are evidence of a massive citywide water system.
Petra was an urban center and it had urban water supply.
There's just one problem with this theory. Petra is in one of the driest places on the planet. If the Great Temple is indeed the heart of a vast engineering system that supplied an entire city with water, where is all that water coming from?